Lancashire gathering of Church of England leaders, lay and ordained, though of course it is that as well. This major event admits church wardens into their important office, and then commissions our parish vision champions and our deanery mission coordinators for Crossroads 2016, and all in the context of an act of Christian worship, and taking us, as the people of God, another step along the road to reform us for the task God has called us to fulfill. Vision 2026 sounds a very long way away, 10 years indeed. And we need to take a number of steps towards that goal. And tonight, as we gather as a large part of the family of God's people, members of the Church of England in Lancashire, this is another important step that we share together. So thank you for making the effort, taking the trouble to be here this evening. Let me draw your attention to one verse from our reading from Acts. It's the last verse in that short reading from Acts chapter 2 and verse 47, where we read, "Day by day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved." It's a statement which can cause us to react in a number of different ways. It might make us feel guilty and rather inadequate, as it's not our current experience and we feel we should be doing more. Or it might make us become rather introspective, examining ourselves and thinking that we might be the problem, that the church isn't growing faster, and so we might tend to a bit of depression. Or it might make us say, well, it was different then. They needed a kickstart at the beginning. But times have changed, and our culture is less open and less responsive, and we shouldn't expect more. Or we might react by wondering whether we're on the right track at all and shouldn't be taking the scriptures so seriously. Or if all that is rather negative, we could react more positively and see that it inspires us to keep focus on the real thing and be confident in what really matters. Day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. It's a statement which I believe inspires us to remember God's plan of salvation for his world. The momentum of that big, long story begins in the Gospels and then is developed in Acts. And the building of that new creation, that redeemed world, all things summed up in the person of Jesus Christ. Or as we sung earlier, every knee bowing and every tongue confessing that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's the end of the story. But in the meantime, there's a call to individuals to buy in and to participate in the fulfilling of that plan. One by one, community by community, moving from that kingdom of darkness under the rule of the prince of this world to the kingdom of light under the rule of Jesus Christ. We should be so encouraged that the Church of Jesus Christ is growing faster today than at any other time in the last 2,000 years. And as disciples today, we are part of that worldwide movement that bears witness to and shares with others the salvation that's found in Christ alone. And so that statement inspires us to remember God's plan. It also inspires us to remember that it's all his work. Day by day, the Lord added to their number. He does the adding to their number. He admits to his kingdom. He's the one who gives eternal life and grants forgiveness. Yes, it will be through the devotion of his disciples, referred to earlier in the reading, to their preaching and teaching, to their fellowship, to their worship and hospitality, and to their prayer. But conversion, a new birth, baptism of the Holy Spirit is something that he does and we cannot. Becoming a Christian is not something that we do for God, but actually something that he does within us and for us. And being a healthy church means keeping Jesus and his work central, being obedient to his word, and sharing that good news about him so that we transform and make an impact for good in the communities where God has placed us. This statement inspires us to remember that it's his work and not ours. But it also inspires us to avoid complacency. The account of the spread of the gospel in the first century should mean we should always look for more and think bigger. And like the statement that somebody once said, God doesn't do average. And yet too often we settle for much less than what God wants to bestow. And we get so used to things being as they are that we cannot imagine any change or development. Witness in that early church was an everyday activity, a part of the everyday way of life of those early disciples. Evangelism, outreach, mission, it wasn't sporadic or occasional. It was regular, day by day, all the time. Just as their worship was daily, we read that in verse 46, so also was their witness. Praise and proclamation are both the natural overflow of hearts full of God's Holy Spirit. In these days, running up to Pentecost, we recall the promise of Jesus to send his Spirit and to clothe his disciples with power from on high. And what a difference that gift of the Spirit of God made to those first disciples, transforming their fear into courage and boldness, and seeing Christian communities popping up all around the ancient world. And we as church need more than anything else. I hardly dare say it, but I will. More even than Vision 2026 is that God should pour out his Spirit upon us afresh and equip us to face the challenges of our day. Somebody said, it's not hard work that wears Christians down, but the toil of working without the power of the Holy Spirit. We need to make that fresh surrender to Jesus, submitting to him as Lord, and that will lead to that fresh filling of the Holy Spirit into our lives and into our communities. All this talk of Vision 2026, all the little banners and things that you see around, all the documents, all the people engaged in it, vision champions, mission coordinators, will be no more than human talk and human effort unless we allow the Spirit of God to fill us, to change us, and make us that transformative influence that he longs for us to be in our different communities. As the psalmist put it years ago, unless the Lord builds the house, its builders labour in vain. And so we are here this evening to give thanks to God for all that he's doing among us, to bring him our praise and adoration, and to offer him our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice for him to use in his service as he pleases. Day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. May he be about that work in our time and in this diocese, to his praise and his glory. And may we be urgent in our praying for our nation and for this country, under the banner of thy kingdom come, and then also work for it as well. Amen. Before I sit down, I please have a few questions that I want to ask you before I take my seat.
Good evening again. I think we've got a little bit quiet. I don't know what you think.
I was talking. You were
excellent.
I was talking and they weren't heckling.
That was good. This afternoon. But to be fair, the people that were heckling is the ones up behind us.
That's going to be an end to next. And purpose in what we're about as church. It's very easy just to get into the routine and the rut of just doing things week by week, month by month, year by year. The same thing happens without really much thought as to why we're doing it. And hopefully Vision 2026 brings to the table some reasons for us to engage in this particular task. And so I hope it will actually give a sense of direction so we know where we're heading and what we want to achieve.
So some people have said to me earlier that we keep going our parish, our church, but now we've got that end goal, we've got somewhere to aim for. Mm-hmm. Then they said, what are we going to do after? Mm-hmm. Is there a planning place for after that? That was a worry about
it. Was it right? Well, I'm going to be glad that people are worrying, but I want to worry about what's happening before first. So get worrying and pray and act for the before, and let's see where that leads us. So then as we get near to 2026, we'll see what actually the next steps are going to be. Church life is all a series of small steps, and we need to see where God leads us the next. If we look too far ahead, we'll be terrified, because God may have got extraordinary plans that will be quite off our radar. So let's go a step at a time and see where it takes us, and 2026 is really as far ahead as we can probably manage.
Certainly, for now, I think that's a wise words indeed. We talk about healthy church and the communities, and how that can have a positive and it can transform communities. I go around as a Brittany Blue judge, and when I see small pockets of people gathering to transform an area, and I go back year after year, 3 years, and you see it from what may be a council estate in Manchester, where a small piece of grass to transform into blooms, into more people gathering together. And is that the sense of what we're trying to get when we talk about transforming impact on our communities, blooming through God's love?
It definitely is, and that's why we want to be good at being church, so that we have that positive influence upon the wider community where God has placed us to be. If we don't make church good, then we have a negative impact. So we need to make church really good and healthy, strong, lively, reverent, all the different aspects of being church. And there's so many different ways of being church, but let's explore all those different ways and do it well, so that people come and visit us. I said, you know, I've got to go back. It was so good this morning. I've got to go back next week. I wonder how many people actually say that after a Sunday morning service. It was so good. It was so real. The faith of the people of God there was so alive. I must go back. So we've got to make church good, so that then that actually spreads out and has an impact upon how we are and who we are. Because it's not just doing church within those four walls. It's actually the lives that we lead outside in our communities, in our places of work. And I often say that, you know, I might preach a sermon, but actually all of us preach a sermon by the lives that we lead. What sermon are we preaching as a church to our communities? And are they hearing something of the person of Jesus Christ and the way that he can make a difference to our lives now and also in eternity?
That's absolutely fantastic. Well, thank you very much indeed. We've got some small videos, that have been recorded, a little clip on the screen now, between all our bishops that have been speaking to you this evening. This is a message from our young people, is trying to give the young people their voice.
Traditional structure in like prayers and ritualistic speaking.
Trying to talk to me but without listening to my views.
Anger. More modern songs and less older ones. Yeah. Attitude, change your attitude.
People practice to see each other, or maybe encourage people to sit in different places each week or something.
The atmosphere and the people around the church.
I like the youth groups because I think they help.
That's what that's about. Growing as disciples is about achieving our full potential as a people born and made for joy.
Well, I've certainly born and made for joy, but how can I be? It's better now. Just because I'm from Atkinson, I don't know how to smile you. How can I be? I'm a Christian chap that works on a Sunday, it's hard work and all that. And, but how can I be one of your disciples to your vision?
It's a journey, isn't it? That process of discovering our purpose in God is a journey, and discipleship is about that process of formation. I was going to bring a visual aid with me today, but I forgot it.
Was it a book?
It was no, it was. It was. I'll tell you what it was. It was a plant pot with a dead plant in it. Because I am the world's worst gardener. My nephew gave me a plant for my birthday, and I killed it within 3 weeks because I failed to feed it, failed to water it, failed to talk to it. In the Gospels, in John chapter 15, Jesus compares us to a plant, to a branch of a vine. In order to grow fruit, we need to be fed like a plant. And discipleship is about how we're fed for the Christian journey. And that happens in all sorts of ways. It happens in worship. We're formed in worship, especially as we meet Jesus in the Eucharist. We're formed in service, especially when we make sacrifices and give our lives to the poor. And the vision talks about three very particular and important ways in which we grow and form as disciples. Through prayer, proper intense prayer, through the study of scripture, being immersed in the scriptures, and through generosity in our lives.
You talk about the intensity of prayer. The last time we prayed together was in a bar in Belfort on Christmas Eve amongst
baby pigs.
You did have a puppy then. And that was an absolutely magical time. And the children at the front there, we've grasped in prayer at that point. There's a gap sometimes, isn't there, that we need to fill as a church. within the vision of keeping hold of our young people and listening to what they have to say.
That's absolutely right, and of course young people are disciples as well, and we're responsible for their growth in faith just as well as our own, really. You know, the importance of young people and children is should be all the way through this vision, putting right at the centre of our life, listening to them and helping to lead us as Christians as well. Children are teachers as well as learners.
We ask, when we talk about what is, how are we going to make disciples of Jesus Christ, and we talk about giving generously of our time. Now, the churches that I go and speak to of an evening and chats with, and the churches where I've worshipped at, it's generally the same 8 to 9 people that kind of keep that ship afloat. The making the tea, the cleaning the church, the going out and speaking to people, who we're out and about, just the absolute, you know, epitome of grafters within our community. Can we ask those people to do even more?
Jesus says, you've received without charge, give without charge. As Christians, we're generous, not in a kind of grudging, mean way. Remember Jack Nichols constantly saying, generosity is measured, not by what we give, but by what we hold back. We're generous in response to God's generosity to us. And of course, the more we're generous, the more that impacts on the lives of those around us. Those vital people in life, many of whom are in this hall tonight, are absolutely essential in keeping the church going. But the more generous they can be, the more we'll find other generous people to share in the work and the witness of the ministry. Generosity is absolutely the hallmark of the Christian life.
If you can, just ask him later to just say a quick family. I wouldn't, that's just a personal thing. Thank you very much, indeed. We're going to be exploring, we have more discussions, more questions that we're going to be asking as well of our leaders. Now we've got more to show you from our young people. Another one of our series of videos where we've asked the young people twice.
Stuff up like, I believe in God, you don't.
Not listening to others.
Don't judge others.
You've got to be humble about it.
You welcome people into the Christian community.
Sharing testimonies.
Showing God's love in more ways than we might imagine?
I think so. I think, I was just so touched on Sunday. I've got a really important meeting tomorrow that I'm really a little bit anxious about. And one of the people just said to me afterwards, Geoff, can I make you some biscuits for the meeting? You know, just to make it go better. And I said, oh, that would be lovely, Mary. There are so many ways of showing up. And communities here represented, whether it's in food banks, you know, whether it's in all sorts of ways of working with young people, there are plenty of people demonstrating God's love.
I think you've touched on a few points there. That people that I've spoken to hold me being able to actually physically do something. So as well as sharing God's love and the power that brings to them on a personal level and telling a neighbour what it does to me, but to do something actual physical, like within the food banks or within the community. And I think that's an integral part of what we're trying to achieve, isn't it?
I think so. I think if you add up and people have done this, you know, the volunteer hours that people put in preparing meals, you know, in working with all sorts of folk, people who are homeless, people with all sorts of complex needs, you'll be amazed actually at the contribution from the community of faith.
Now I pray where I can in three separate locations at the minute, just like I've got five witches around Lancashire. When you find a good church, you go back, where I do, if I can, during the week.
Right.
But we're talking about planting and renewing 50 new strategic congregations, like the ghostly I was in, pretty strategic, and I'm fairly sure that everybody sat in this room will say that their congregation is pretty strategic to their community as well. So what's the difference to these 50 new?
Well, I think, with all honesty, we as a church are only reaching a certain percentage of the population. There are people that somehow we are not connecting with them and sharing the love of Jesus. So there are people groups, there may be areas in our parishes, there may be people with particular needs. You know, we've got new communities starting with people who are recovering from all sorts of addictions. We've got places where the church just needs revitalizing. There are so many opportunities to plant churches and to revitalize others.
And maybe to change where and when is that?
Yeah. I think we've got to be flexible, haven't we? I heard of a survey this morning, or was it Saturday, where one of the parishes in Blackpool did a survey, and 40% of the people said, we want a service not on a Sunday morning. 40%. So that is a huge, you know, group of people to try and reach. And that church responded to that request by putting on a midweek service.
Well, that's good news.
It is.
And let's share that good news and continue to do so. Thank you very much. The Bishop of Lancaster. All the giant acts we've been up with.
I am.
So steady on. Lancaster City. Once again, now aren't we, because we don't know what we're going to say on the video that's going to come next. We're quaking because save the times, the cheer up, basically, the last two, so we should see what our young people say on the final video.
Responsibility.
Give them confidence.
They tell you about God.
difficult introduction that the Archdeacon Mark has called out. Get all of yourself! Get all of them! It's interesting. It is interesting what perceptions out there, the challenges that we face as a modern nature.
Brilliant contributions. Can I just say, Stephen, welcome, how wonderful your radio programme is. How great it is. I'm so excited to be back in the Diocese of Blackburn and Wales.
You're not being me, fancy, you're not actually moving. Was that just to get away from the get all of yourself?
I'm glad that we're listening tonight to the voices of young people, because actually I was 17 years old when I sensed that God was calling me to full-time Christian life. And there were people who told me to go away and grow up and do something else until I was a bit more mature. But I'm grateful for a little church, a little village congregation that listened to me and welcomed me, and invited me, even at the age of 17, to get up and speak in the May morning service. Looking back, it was probably a pretty beautiful talk. But nobody told me that. They encouraged me and prayed for me. And I'm so grateful. And if one thing we take away from tonight is encouraging a new generation of young leaders coming forward and supporting them and listening to them, even when we sometimes have to get a translation of what they've actually said, then we will be doing something very precious to God.
We're talking about liberating the lay leadership, greater participation. Do you see the future that within and the young people coming into the lay leadership?
I do. In one church I've been to recently, I was just so excited to meet the peace team, who are a bunch of very young people doing full-time work, Christian work, as a gap year. And I can tell you, if you pray with a team from the peace team, it's exhausting. They are so passionate and so excited for God. And that's going to be the future for us, because if we're going to plant those 50 new congregations that Geoff was talking to us about, we're going to need a lot more leaders. And amazingly, across the country, 40% of the new congregations that are being planted are led by lay people with no training and no formal authorization, but they just have sensed a call from God to get out there and to lead.
40% is a huge number. How do we make that 50? How do we encourage even more people to stand up, to turn? All the different times that we're going to have worship, in all the different places of the diocese. How do we get our message out there?
By seeking a fresh Pentecost. I think that's what we're here about tonight. We've been praying for the Holy Spirit to come, because the Holy Spirit came on sad and broken people who were hiding away behind locked doors, and suddenly there was no stopping Peter. We didn't have time for his whole sermon this evening. We just got the first bit of the ending. But the disciples went out everywhere. They turned the world upside down, and they were willing to risk everything. That video at the beginning this evening reminded us that we're lucky. We have freedom to worship, and yet we make excuses for not being there and not doing things. Praise God for the freedoms we have. But we need the Holy Spirit, because without God's power at work, we'll just be empty, hanging symbols.
And it's time for the excuses to stop that.
It is.
For us to take what we learn from each other and what we gather from each other, from fantastic events and congregations or congregation within our own area, to take that message out. What would you say to people who maybe are a little bit scared, perhaps, of stepping from outside of the parish to move into these new areas, to speak into new people?
Can I tell you about a woman's story?
Yes.
I tell you what it is. A few months ago, I started to learn to sail. I turned up at the sailing club, and because it was a free taste today, and I thought I was wanting to come here, I'll turn up. And no sooner I got there, someone said, "Come out in my boat." And then they said, "Would you like to take the tiller?" That was a mistake, because within 30 seconds, I capsized the boat. It was his boat. and the mast was stuck in the mud at the bottom of the reservoir. But at the end of it, he said, why don't you come back and join this course? And so I came back and joined the course. When I got on the course, that didn't work out very well, so I put it along the group. But there was a chap of mine who said, you're struggling. Let me just explain to you what's happening. Let me take you out. And every week, he just turned up to see if I'd be there, to see if I was all right. He loved sailing, and he just wanted me to get about it. That's all it takes, is one person to just come alongside another person who might be taking the first tentative step and say, can I help you? Can I encourage you? Can I walk with you?
So be like Mike.
Be like Mike.
That's a great blessing. Thank you very much indeed, Archdeacon.